Welcome to Guideline Updates with MedStudy. My name is Dr. Vijay Pottathil, and I'd like to discuss the newest ACG guidelines regarding the diagnosis and management of gastroesophageal reflux disease that came out in early 2022. The good news is that the guidelines are consistent and mostly the same from the previous iteration. I'll be highlighting the differences. GERD is caused by transient lower esophageal reflux disease, and the two most sensitive symptoms that manifest in patients are regurgitation and heartburn. If a patient has classic GERD symptoms, the recommendation, consistent with previous guidelines, is an empiric trial of PPI therapy for 8 weeks. Unlike the past guidelines where patients were kept on PPI therapy indefinitely, this updated guideline recommends discontinuing PPI therapy after 8 weeks. Now, if a patient has recurrent symptoms, or never responds to the PPI therapy in the first place, the recommendation is to pursue an upper endoscopy. The purpose of the upper endoscopy is to determine if the patient has erosive esophagitis or non-erosive reflux disease. So if you look at figure one in the guidelines, you'll see that at the time of endoscopy, we will be looking for whether the patient has LA class B, C, or D erosive esophagitis or Barrett's esophagus greater than 3 centimeters, which would confirm a diagnosis of GERD. If the patient has LA class A erosive esophagitis or a normal endoscopy, the recommendation is to pursue reflux monitoring, which could be a 24-hour or a 48-hour pH study. So that covers the diagnostic elements of GERD. With regards to management, there is moderate data that recommending weight loss is a good idea. There is a high level of evidence that PPI therapy is superior to H2 blockers or antacids, both for initial treatment as well as maintenance, and that these should be taken 30 to 60 minutes before breakfast. With regards to other lifestyle modifications, I would bring your attention to the figure in the guidelines to assess the strength of different recommendations and tailor your recommendations after interviewing the patient and determining what might make sense. The next section of the guidelines discuss potential extra esophageal manifestations of GERD. These could include globus sensation, atypical cough, etc. The guidelines make a distinction between someone with these symptoms plus typical GERD symptoms, which would include regurgitation and heartburn, or a patient who only has these symptoms and does not have typical GERD. If a patient has typical GERD, the guidelines are recommending 8 to 12 weeks of PPI therapy. If the patient does not have typical GERD, the recommendation is to proceed straight to reflux monitoring, which is 24 or 48 hour pH studies. The final section of the guidelines discuss the potential for surgical intervention. There is moderate evidence that in patients with established GERD, one can proceed with surgical intervention such as the Nissen fundoplication for managing GERD that's refractory to medical therapy. In addition, there's the recommendation to pursue or consider a Roux-en-Y procedure in a patient who is obese with plus or minus metabolic disease. With respect to more cutting-edge endoscopic interventions, the evidence is lower, and so the recommendation is a little ambivalent. Finally, I would bring your attention to the last table in the guidelines that discuss the potential side effects of PPI therapy. This has been a big issue nationally because their data came out in the last 5 to 10 years that there are potential side effects to PPI therapy. And because of this, we are recommending now to be on the lowest dose that's effective, as well as discontinuing therapy when feasible. But overall, the guidelines are still recommending to use PPI therapy when it's appropriate. Thank you for listening to this presentation.